Texas leading 9-6. Jim Cott, Tim Brando here at Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, Nebraska. This is game three of the NCAA College World Series, going to the top half of the sixth inning with Texas and Arkansas in a seesaw battle. Pitchers have struggled. There's been lots of walks, but there's been some good clutch hitting and a lot of runs scored by these Southwest Conference rivals. Texas leading it 9-6. As Brian Cesarek leads off the top half of the sixth and takes a strike. He was at bat when Texas put on the delayed steal. Kobe Curlin caught off, but while he was being run down, Alanis Westbrook scoring from third base for the fourth run of the fifth inning for Texas. Base hit up the middle for Cesarek. A leading hitter for Texas came into the game hitting .424, is now 2-for-3 in the ballgame. And that'll lift it a notch as he goes for the all-time Texas record, which is .417. That's some hitter, Cesarek.
He's never, as we said early on in the game, never been below .414 all year.
I robbed him of a point. He came into the game hitting .425. Scott Coolball, the third baseman, takes a breaking pitch inside. Cesarek, we're told, is now up to .428.
Well above the Mendoza line. Remember the Mendoza line? Mario Mendoza.
Down low, count is 2-0.
Mario Mendoza was a slick fielding shortstop, but not known for his bat. And every week in the stat sheet, everybody would try to get above that Mendoza line, which was usually in the high 100s or low 200s.
Zarek, not great speed, but he can run pretty well. Meanwhile, Tim Peters falls behind 3-0 on Scott Coolball. Peters, the third pitcher for Arkansas in the ballgame. Left-hander John Sebahar started. Ray Harris relieved him in a second. That's fastball over. Peters came on in the fifth inning. Norm DeBrien has been looking for a pitcher who could get people out. Texas has been held scoreless only once in the ballgame.
Well, another 9 runs. The Arkansas pitching staff has walked 8 hitters. 5 of those have scored. So 5 of the base on balls have scored today. More than half of the runs for the Longhorns.
A pitch inside and another walk. That is 9 walks issued by Arkansas pitchers in the ballgame. Runners at first and second with nobody out.
I would expect we might see Bobby Edwards rather quickly, because if there's one man on the Arkansas staff not overpowering, he's really a junk ball pitcher, off-speed pitcher, but he only has 12 walks all season. That's in 71 innings. That's good ratio.
And Arkansas with 2 more pitchers warming up. The right-hander is Bob Edwards. The left-hander is Keith Helton, senior left-hander. Edwards has been used in relief 31 times this season. He's starting to loosen up.
Yeah.
Edwards, a junior from Salt Lake City. Texas threatening. Runners at first and second. Scott Bryant, the designated hitter, is up. He's had 2 hits and a walk.
Well, Arkansas right now defensing for the punt, but Scott Bryant, the DH, and his ability to hit the ball the other way, I'm not too sure Gus is going to have him bunting.
He squares and bunts foul. And Arkansas put the defensive play on with a third baseman, Thomas, charging, and the shortstop, Cisco, going over to cover third. Cesarek, the runner at second, going back. There's Thomas staying in on the infield grass.
You can see him glance in at the bench right there. That's what he's trying to do, is get the signal to see what kind of defensive alignment DeBrien will use right here.
Now, last inning, Gustafson had Lenny Bell bunting on the first pitch, then allowed him to swing away.
I think he'll swing away right here. We'll see.
Kramer's the first baseman, is still up on the infield grass. Thomas is back, even with a bag on the dirt. He squares the bunt, bunts it foul. And Bryant, upset with himself.
DHs don't often bunt well anyway. They're in there in a DH spot because they can swing the bat, same way with cleanup hitters. You don't see many cleanup hitters that are good bunters. They don't do it very often.
Freshman Scott Bryant, senior right-hander Tim Peters. Missed outside. And a credit to the job Bryant has done in the game. Two hits and a walk that took Gustafson, has allowed him to stay in as the DH. He's got a good one on the left side with Mike Patrick.
He's hanging with him with this lead. Look at this pitch right there. That's very close pitch. Yesterday, strike three.
1-2 on the ground foul. Different day, different umpire.
Different umpire. And in fairness to Bill Rosenberry, it's not that he has had really that tight a strike zone, but anytime you have a game where the pitchers are all over the place like they have been today, you don't get the same consistent job from the home plate umpire that you get when you have the quality pitchers that we saw yesterday.
Bill Rosenberry is the man calling balls and strikes. Bryant takes low and away. Bryant's done a good job up at the plate. He's gone with the pitch well in his earlier at-bats. Here he's fought off a couple of two-strike pitches. Got the count even at 2-2. Runners go. Pitch is taken. The throw down to third is in the dirt and he's safe. So Texas catches Arkansas by surprise. Thomas, the third baseman, was not in position to take that throw, and the double steal works.
Once again, an example of the lackluster play really today. Everybody caught back on their heels. When we trace it all to the ineffectiveness of the pitchers, the base on ball right here, Thomas, late cover in the bag, actually makes a fine pick on that throw, but cannot get there in time to make the tag.
3-2 pitch, and Bryant works a walk. And the bases are loaded for Texas with nobody out here in the top half of the sixth inning. And another walk to the mound for Norm DeBryan. He has made that trip several times this afternoon. And he'll bring the right-hander. Bob Edwards is getting the call. So Arkansas trailing 9-6 and Texas threatening for more. As Norm DeBryan and the Razorback desperately look for someone who can throw strikes and get some people out. Bob Edwards comes on. He's the fourth Arkansas pitcher in the ballgame. Four. Sebahar walked three. Harris walked three. Infield in at first and third. Shortstop in second looking for two. The breaking ball for a strike gets off the catcher's glove. Skeels gets there.
Might be right there, Sam. That might be that pitch that's hard to handle. First time I've ever heard of it. The splinker. Bobby Edwards throws a splinker, and we think that is a split finger fastball and a sinker combined.
Well, we've heard of the slurve, so here comes the splinker. See the Arkansas defense. Nobody out. The bases loaded for Texas. Todd Haney, the batter. Fastball on the inside corner. Right-hander Bob Edwards on the mound. He's 6'4", 185 pounds, 21 years old, a junior from Salt Lake City. Breaking ball, foul back, and then hung up there a little bit. Count remains 0-2. For the Arkansas pitcher, Sebahar, who started, threw 22 balls, 28 strikes in an inning and two-thirds. Harris in 2 1/3 pitched 32 balls and 21 strikes. And then Peters in one inning, 19 balls and 18 strikes. Missed up high and away.
Not going to win any teddy bears at the county fair with that kind of control.
Count is 1-2 on Todd Haney, second baseman for the Texas Longhorns. Breaking ball hit up the middle. Nice play by Zane over to Cisco. The first not in time. Kelly Zane with a good backhand stab gets the fourth and second. Bryant is retired, but meanwhile, Brian Cesarek comes in to score, and Texas now leads 10-6.
See, good play right here by Kelly Zane. See him get in position with that little jump step, makes the good backhand. All he can do is flip it. Now, Cisco, quick feet, quick pivot, but no chance to get the double play. They executed as well as they could.
Brings up Lenny Bell, the first baseman. Runners at first and third, and Texas has been starting to run with the lead. They've moved people. Haney can run at first base. Breaking pitch in the dirt. Cool ball is at third. Haney at first with one man out. Curveball hit hard, deep to left center field. That'll go to the wall. And one bounce up against the wall. Cool ball is in. Here comes Haney to score on his way to third. And in with a triple is Lenny Bell. It's 12-6 Texas. He caught a hanger from Bob Edwards and put it one bounce up against the wall in deep left center.
Here's where those high off-speed pitches will end up most of the time. Lenny Bell with a good swing at this one. Another look at his swing. Quick bat, good mechanics. Of course, they're swinging that light 29-ounce metal bat. They whip it through there quite well. But he's taking advantage of his chance to play.
Rusty Crockett takes the fastball for a strike from Bob Edwards.
Anybody that joined us late, normally Lenny Bell does not play, but when Kevin Garner pitches, then Cesarek goes to right field. He gets a chance to play. That's his first triple of the year, and he picks up a couple of more RBIs.
Still only one out, infield in for Arkansas, as they now trail by six. Texas got a run top of the first. Arkansas answered with a run in the bottom. Texas got three in the top of the second, and Arkansas answered back with three in the bottom of the second. Texas a run in the third, Arkansas two in the bottom of the fourth to take the lead 6-5. Texas four in the fifth. The squeeze is on and it works. Beautiful bunt, and Crockett is safe. And Texas doing it all right now. The Longhorns lead 13-6.
Normally, Sam, this would not be the kind of play. If you're on the Arkansas team, you'd be happy with it when the team's got you down six runs and they use the squeeze. But that's an indication, again, of how the game has changed. You see wide open games like this with so much scoring, and you got to say, hey, we're going to get all the runs we can get. We don't care what the score is.
Bell breaking from third. Four runs in for Texas here in the sixth inning. Longhorns leading 13-6. Breaking ball to the catcher, Brian Johnson. And Johnson has hit the ball hard in this game with two doubles. Johnson had an outstanding regional in the Central Regional, hit 375, and he's just continued on here. Runner goes. Pitch is taken high, and a throw down, not in time. And again, Steele throwing off to the shortstop side of second base.
It all goes back to the one thing. Because the pitchers don't hold runners on well, Skiles has to alter his natural throwing motion just to try to get rid of the ball and get it down there. You see the jump he gets right there. No contest. Ooh, almost pulled his foot off the bag. See him unload that rather quickly.
Back to the live action. The count is 2-1 on the catcher, Brian Johnson. One man out. Crockett, the runner at second. Inside. Johnson in the Central Regional was 5-for-14. Hit 357 with a home run and six RBIs. Starts off the College World Series with two doubles, a couple of RBIs. Good fastball from Edwards.
there's a name, if you follow college baseball, you might just pencil in and watch all next year. Brian Johnson, he's going to emerge, I believe, as a star on this Texas ball club.
3-2 pitch. Curveball swung on and missed. So Edwards gets an out. Two men down here in the top half of the sixth inning. And Alanis Westbrook will step in. Texas Longhorns coming up with four runs in the fifth, four more here in the sixth. Curveball on the inside corner. Westbrook's drafted out of high school by the Yankees. Come on in his senior year, hitting 283, but missed 25 games. Pops the ball up in the infield. Mike Sisko, the shortstop, calls for it and puts it away. Texas building the lead against Southwest Conference rival Arkansas. We go to the bottom of the sixth. It's 13-6 Texas. That help a team win a ball game like this situation. Arkansas looking for a big inning. Bases loaded. Watch the play by the first baseman, Lenny Bell. He makes a diving stab. He goes to the plate. A perfect throw on his knees. It helped prevent a bigger inning for Arkansas. The Razorbacks got two in the fourth inning, but it might have been more if Lenny Bell hadn't come up with that play. The Maniac making his diving play.
He's trying to make the same kind of play.
That's a good point, Sam, because you never know when a base hit like that may open up a ball game. And certainly we know from watching this game that there's plenty of opportunities from both ball clubs, even though it's 13-6. The lead does not appear to be too comfortable. In fact, Pat Kizik had such a long inning. He went down to the bullpen during that inning and played some catch.
Top of the order for Arkansas. The right fielder, Scott Pose, takes the strike. Pose got on a sacrifice bunt and an error last time up. Good fastball. Pat Kizik just reaching back and throwing the number one pitch.
But I think now he's in a position where he knows he can rely a little bit more on his stuff and not be too control conscious.
Got him. Took a little off. Strikes out Pose. Long way to come back now for Arkansas.
Amazing what a seven-run lead will do to relax a pitcher. Now all of a sudden you see three good pitches in a row right in the strike zone, and look at the excellent movement on that one. Much more relaxed, and it all goes back to that good wrist action. When you got that nice lead, you're loosey-goosey, you got a loose wrist, that's where you get the good movement on the ball.
Kelly Zane, a single and a walk in the ball game.
Of course, the good ones do that when the game is 1-1, 2-1.
It was Zane who hit that ground ball on which Lenny Bell made the outstanding defensive play. The next hitter, Kramer's, then doubled in a couple of runs. He got a base hit to drive in a couple of runs, but that play helped prevent an even bigger inning. Good fastball from Petkaisik. Had a good year. That has been overshadowed by Kevin Garner and Kurt Krippner. Line foul down the right field side.
Talked about all the history of Texas pitchers. Cliff Gustafson still says he thinks the greatest college pitcher that he has seen is a fellow that's helping him volunteer coach right now, Bert Hooten.
Pitch blown away.
And in the light of the controversy and the criticism of overworking college pitchers, Gus said, here's one guy that he pitched nine innings, give him a day's rest, pitched nine more, and he lasted in the big leagues 15 years.
Into the air to right field. Cesarek goes over, got the sunglasses down, and makes the catch. The sun can be real tough in the late afternoon, and now it's 6:20 here in Omaha, Nebraska. Cesarek, who is not used to playing the outfield all that much, played most of the season at first base. There you see, bright sunshiny day, temperature around 80 degrees. play game three of the NCAA College World Series. Here's Jim Kramers, and what a game he's had for Arkansas. He doubled with the bases loaded to drive in three runs back in the second. Single to drive in two back in the fourth.
Kind of unusual, Sam. You've got a guy who leads the Razorbacks in extra base hits, has some sock, and can pull the ball, and look at the gap they give him in right center. They shade him to left center.
Fastball up and in. One thing about these two teams, they don't have to go running around looking for scouting reports. The coaches know the teams very well. Sixth meeting of the season between these two teams. Did he go around on the pitch in the dirt? No, says the third base umpire. Checked with Hank Roundtree. That time Hank may have given him a break on that one.
Yeah, we saw those earlier in the game called strikes.
Count is 2-1 on Jim Kramers, leading hitter for the Arkansas Razorbacks. Surprised that Kisak is not challenging him at this stage with a 7-run lead. Looks like he's trying to finesse him a little bit. There's the fastball, but he missed. Kramers draws a 2-out walk.
I don't think
the bottom half of the sixth.
Excuse me, Sam. I don't think the pitchers brought that word with them to the ballpark today. Challenge. He left it home.
Though Petkisic has certainly helped Cliff Gustafson by staying in the ball game and keeping Arkansas from getting more than they already had. He scored 4 runs off the starter Kevin Garner in an inning and 2/3. Petkisic came on in the second. Allowed 2 runs in the fourth. And he's still in there. Andy Skeels, the catcher, leading home run hitter for Arkansas. Takes a curveball for a strike. Outfield straight away on Skeels. Give him the lines a little bit. Check swing off the curveball and it's foul. And Petkisic ahead 0-2. Third team All-America catcher Andy Skeels against Mark Petkisic. Petkisic was the starter and winner in the second regional game in the Central Regional, beat Oklahoma 10-5. That one's hit deep to right field. Cesarek is there and makes the catch. Hit well by Andy Skeels, but Cesarek playing him perfectly, catching it 2 steps in front of the warning track. 6 innings complete in Game 6 of the NCAA College World Series. In Game 3, Texas is leading 13-6. Keith Kearns of Arkansas came to the plate in Game 1 of the 85 College World Series with a chance to win the game in extra innings. But Kearns failed to get his bat on the ball on a suicide squeeze attempt. And after 13 innings of scoreless baseball, the Razorbacks had the feeling they'd never score. Kearns changed that with his next swing of the bat. Fastball hit in the air, base hit right center field. Roberts is around third, heading for the plate. We don't have that kind of ball game today.
Nice sport.
He's enjoying it, though.
Yeah, he's holding up one for that score. It was 1-0, but it's a different story today. This is more like the fans are used to seeing the Texas-Arkansas football battles right here, 13-6.
Another pitching change for the Razorbacks of Arkansas. They bring in Mike Oquist, freshman from La Junta, Colorado. 6'2", 265 pounds. Oquist making his 17th appearance of the season, 12th in relief. Record of 2-2. 44 and a third inning pitched. He struck out 50. Toby Kerlin singled his last time up. Started the game hitting right-handed against the left-handers, Sebahar and Harris, and turned around. Got a base hit.
Norm DeBrine has to space his relief pitchers out a little bit, not overuse any of them, because if this score holds up, he's got to come right back tomorrow, as you mentioned, in that loser's bracket, and he's going to want his as many of his pitchers fresh as possible.
I think that may have been the thinking in taking Edwards out of the ballgame and putting in the less experienced and less frequently used Oquist.
Well, you can bet in tomorrow's game because his starter tonight, today, John Sebahar, only went an inning and two-thirds. He'll be ready to come back tomorrow.
1-2 to Kerlin. Got him on a fastball. Kerlin a little upset with a couple of the calls on the outside corner and then went down swinging.
See the good fastball right here. Oquist has good strikeout ratio. Once again, that area up and in on a left-hand pitcher. That's where you get the majority of your strikeouts.
And here's Brian Cesarek, leading hitter for Texas, now up to 428, 2-for-3 in the ball game. Shown us some fine bat work. Cesarek goes around 5'10". 160 pounds, and he's played mostly first base, but I imagine, Jim, if he's going to have a chance in the pros, he might have to look elsewhere for position.
Well, they're concerned as a pro prospect, really, of where to look at them. He does not have that strong an arm, and if he played one of the outfield positions, he's a good average hitter, but not a lot of power.
He has worked hard to become a good first baseman and has done a good job for Texas this season. And Lenny Bell has played quite a ball game.
He really has. Base. And gotten a big triple, a couple RBIs.
Good fastball. Boy, Oquist. Play that country hardball right now.
Well, all they're looking for is somebody like him that can come in and at least throw strikes. That's been their downfall today. 10 walks. 6 of those 10 have scored.
Count is full on Brian Cesarek.
One of the things Norm DeBrine said we have to do against Texas is to generate more offense. And here his team comes up with 6 runs in the first 4 innings today, and they can't hang on. Got to be very disappointing to him.
Missed. And that is walk number 11 drawn by Texas, given up by Arkansas pitchers. And here is a look at the Arkansas bench. Not too happy down there.
These games when your pitchers walk a lot, boy, they put you in a trance. No fun sitting in the dugout when your pitcher's out there throwing ball after ball.
Got Kubal, the cleanup man, leading RBI man for Texas, the only player in the ball game without an RBI for Texas. Hit hard, deep to left center field. Moore going back, but he's there and makes the catch. Cesarek goes back to first. 2 men out. Scott Bryant steps in against the freshman Mike Oquist. Bryant's had a couple of hits, walked once. We're in the top half of the seventh inning. This is game three of the NCAA College World Series. Texas leading Arkansas 13-6. Game four, 8 o'clock Eastern time. John Sanders and Joe Morgan will be here to bring you the game between Stanford and Georgia. Georgia making its first appearance ever in the College World Series. Following this game, we'll go to SportsCenter. Stay with us. Get you up to date on everything that happened in sports today. Fastball is fouled away. And then back out to Rosenblatt Stadium for game four of the series. Tomorrow afternoon, Jim and I will be here. 5 o'clock Eastern time for game five, a loser's bracket game, an elimination game. Arizona State will take on Florida State. Time has been called. Cesarek wants to check with Coach Bill Bethay. Wants to make sure he didn't miss a sign.
Probably saying, I thought I saw a steal sign, but I don't think Gus would have me stealing in a 13-6 ball game. So he wanted to check with Bill Bethay.
Well, Cesarek pulled a heads-up double steal when he was on the front end of that double steal last inning. Fastball just missed low. Scott Bryant. Bryant inserted as a designated hitter. And done well. Came into the ball game, hitting just 250. 11 for 44. Tim Brando's alongside the Arkansas dugout. Tim?
Sam, both you and Jim have speculated as to the reason for bringing in the latest addition, the new pitcher in the game, Mike Oak, which obviously they want to keep their pitchers fresh. They'll use everyone on their staff with the exception of Fletcher, who should start tomorrow's game if need be.
Good fastball. Bryant missing.
You see the life on Mike Oakquist's fastball right here. A little late movement, almost a little rise to it right at the end. Good live fastball, just a freshman.
A strong arm. Again, the fastball, a base hit to right field. Third hit in the game for Scott Bryant. Cesarek will go to third. The throw is cut off. And Texas with runners at first and third and two men out here in the seventh inning as Scott Bryant continues to impress with that good hitting and again taking the ball to right field.
Oh, he's perfect. He's got three hits and a couple of walks outside part of the plate. See the head right down on it. Watch the ball hit the bat. Use good hitting technique, good mechanics. It pays off. Three for three and a couple of walks.
That'll earn him another look. Somewhere along the line, coach will say, hey, this guy's got a hot bat. Here's Todd Haney, the second baseman. Fastball up high. Once again, walks getting Arkansas in trouble. A walk to Cesarek. Bryant singles, and Texas threatening to add to the 13-6 lead. Fastball foul back over the roof and out of the ballpark. Todd Haney has really worked on his fielding. Cliff Gustafson, coming into this year, had some doubts about whether Haney would be his second baseman. But Haney worked on his fielding to the point where Gustafson said, okay, he can be the man. And he's produced well with a bat as well, hitting 316. Curveball hit in the air to right field. Scott Pose moves over and makes the catch. Texas gets a hit, leaves two, and we go to the bottom of the seventh. Only the second inning of the ball game, Texas has not scored. We go to the bottom of the seventh. Excitement abounds in the National Hockey League as the Philadelphia Flyers and Edmonton Oilers will play one game for the Stanley Cup. They've played six already. They're all even. We'll have the championship game for you tomorrow night live at 8 o'clock Eastern time. Mike Emmerich, Bill Clement, and Tom Meese will bring you all the action from the Northlands Coliseum. So be with us tomorrow night live at 8 o'clock Eastern for the championship game. Game 7 of the Stanley Cup Finals, Philadelphia and Edmonton.
Surprised a few people. That baby going 7 games.
Philly coming back to win games
5-6 after trailing 2-0 in both games. And how about the Boston Celtics beating the Detroit Pistons today?
Another great series.
Hit foul by Troy Eklund, the designated hitter, leading off the bottom half of the seventh inning.
Seems like try to beat the Celtics in a seventh game in Boston Garden, you could almost just save your airfare. I mean, the Sixers did it a few years ago, but not many teams do it.
The Pistons blew their chance in game five. It is 0-2 on Troy Eklund. And following this half inning, we're going to go live to Boston Garden. Casey Jones is standing by with our John Saunders to talk about the Celtics victory and advancing to the finals to play the LA Lakers. Another Celtics-Lakers final.
I bet they each got a towel in their hand. I understand it was 97 degrees in the Garden at game time.
A towel or a fan? Waving the fan. Curveball on the ground. Nubbed. The Lenny Bell went right through his legs. Now Lenny Bell has made some outstanding defensive plays in this game. There's this little squibber down the first baseline, and it rolls right between his legs. And boy, is he embarrassed.
Well, it's one of, you're right about, that's a good word. That's one of the most embarrassing plays for a player, but yet it is, it's one of the more difficult in terms of a player, since I hate to have those squibbers with that corkscrew spin hit at me. They'd much rather have a sharp one hopper. 9 out of 10 go under, didn't get the ball, didn't get the glove down. Well, and from World Series, the memories of Bill Buckner on the same type of play.
Well, fortunately for Lenny Bell, he's done enough so he won't have to stay awake at night thinking about that ball going through his legs. Plus Texas leading by 7. Off the hands. Bell goes over, makes the play again, a tough play, and they got him at first. Tough throw and a good play by the pitcher, Petkisic. Curlin and Eklund joking about that little rubber.
Tougher to jam guys with metal bats, but Petkisic does a good job. This little blooper right there. Bell almost overruns it. Kind of good. I'm not too sure that Petkisic had him out. He was standing behind the bag and put the tag on him. I really think the runner was safe at first base in that play.
Here's Don Thomas, the third baseman. One man out, runner at second. Texas leading 13-6. Bottom half of the seventh inning. If the winner of this game will play again on Tuesday night. Loser has to come back tomorrow night. Good fastball. Throwdown is in the dirt. That slipped out of the hands of Brian Johnson. His mask went flying. Mask almost went as far as the throw. Bounced on the front of the mound.
His mask fired that baby off toward the dugout. He broke his mask right here. See it come loose. His arm hits the mask on the way through.
And I think that affected the throw. Wow.
I'd like to have a sinker like that. That can be a little tough on the elbow, hitting that baby with the mask every time like Johnson did. He went back and got a new one. The strap had busted.
Down is 0-2 on Don Thomas. Fastball's up high. Arkansas battled Texas right down to the wire in the Southwest Conference. Down to the final weekend series, down to the final game of the regular season, Texas won the conference, won the conference tournament, and Arkansas went to Huntsville to play in the regional. Don Thomas called out on strike, a good curveball by Petkisic. Two men out, and Rod Moore, the center fielder, will step in, and Arkansas won four straight in that regional, two against Clemson, a tough Clemson team. Well, the Razorbacks don't have much to root or cheer about right now. Good fastball.
sign in the back of that guy's shirt, I ain't afraid of no Longhorns. But the Razorback pitchers today pitched like they were afraid of the Longhorn hitters. They walked far too many.
Just missed with a breaking ball. Petkisic has pitched five innings, coming on in relief of Kevin Garner, has allowed four hits. Garner giving up four runs in an inning and two-thirds. And that pitch is in for a strike. It's one and two. I understand we have a little problem about getting up to Boston Live, to Boston Garden. We hope to go there a little later on. Stay with us. John Saunders standing by at the Garden, where the Celtics 1-7. Pistons had the chance in game five, and Isaiah Thomas threw the ball away with 5 seconds to go.
Well, he just a fundamental play again, not really throwing it away, but having an alert Larry Bird, the combination of that and not a crisp pass into Bill Laimbeer.
2-2 on Rod Moore. Changeup, struck him out. Petkisic puts down Arkansas, scoreless for three straight innings. We go to the eighth in game three, and Texas leads it 13-6. They went back and forth in the early innings, and then Texas broke out with four runs in the fifth and four more in the sixth to open up a seven-run lead. Rusty Crockett had a big triple. He drove in two runs. Lenny Bell, 2-for-3 in the ball game. Couple of RBIs, and he ripped this one. A triple for Lenny Bell. We go to the top half of the eighth inning, and Lenny Bell will lead it off for the Longhorns of Texas against the freshman Mike Oquist, pitching his second inning. Fastball hit high and deep to left field. Campbell going back on the warning track, makes the catch in front of the wall. Just got under it a little bit. Otherwise, Lenny Bell would have put that one out of here.
Now, hitters get a little more loose and relaxed, as pitchers do when they have a big lead. They're going up there freewheeling right now. Look at the swing of Lenny Bell. Just missed getting a home run. He's already has a triple today.
Here's Rusty Crockett. Four. As I mentioned, since being inserted in the starting lineup, has played very well. 10-for-27. In seven straight games as a starter in left field for Texas. Junior from Crescent, Oklahoma. Loser of this game will play the loser of tonight's game between Stanford and Georgia in the second game tomorrow night. That pitch in the dirt bounces off the glove of Andy Skeels back to the screen. The winner of today's game will play the winner of the night game tonight in a winner's bracket game Tuesday night.
So by tomorrow night, we will already have two teams eliminated from the 87 College World Series.
First game tomorrow afternoon at 5 o'clock Eastern time. Arizona State meets Florida State. Jim and I will have all the action for you. Crockett walks on four pitches, and he's got good speed. He's done a lot of running today. And the way Texas has been running, who knows? Arkansas go for more.
Arkansas, Sam, excuse me, has had one inning today, and that's back in the third. They gave up a few hits, but that's the only inning they have not issued a base on balls.
Brian Johnson has hit the ball hard. Last time he struck out on a breaking ball, but he's had two doubles. Fastball stays inside. 12 walks issued in the ball game by the Arkansas pitchers, four pitchers. John Sebahar started. Ray Harris came on in the second. This is five pitchers now, I should say, for Arkansas. Runner fakes going. Tim Peters, followed by Bob Edwards, and now Mike Oquist. Peters relieved in the fifth, Edwards in the sixth. Both those right-handers would be available to pitch tomorrow. Throw to first. Crockett has to dive back in. Already know Monday night's winner's bracket game will be between Oklahoma State and LSU. Runner goes. Pitch is foul back. Way up high and out of the ballpark. And once again, Crockett on the move. And just part of that philosophy of there never are enough runs in college baseball.
I think that's the reason, because under normal circumstances, this late in the game, 13-6, you would not be playing for an extra run. Obviously, you take it. You'll take all you get, but you're not going to go out of your way to hit and run or steal or manufacture a lot of extra runs with a seven-run lead.
Crockett dives back in. Crockett is one of those players who's on his own on the bases, and he may be just looking to steal and unnerve Arkansas. Again, part of the Southwest Conference rivalry between these two teams.
Come up to bat again. That's a good way to get a crease in your neck doing things like that.
Close. Pretty good move by the right-hander Oquist. The ball over there in a hurry. Count is 2-1 on the catcher Brian Johnson as Rusty Crockett leads the way. One man out. Top half of the eighth inning. Runner goes. Pitch taken, Skeel throw is there, and he's out. Now, part of that, I believe, had to do with the fact that Oquist did a pretty good job of keeping Crockett close.
He really did, and I'm not an advocate of throwing over to first base too often, but there you get a look at there. Oquist unloads the ball, Skeels with the ball up in the strike zone, easy to handle. And an accurate throw, and they got him.
Kelly Zane putting the tag on him. Two men out now in the eighth inning. And the pitch to Johnson is fouled back. Count is full.
Threw over there just enough and had Crockett on a couple of close plays there, as you mentioned. Prevent him from getting that extra quick step.
And that play so close that that half step or maybe a step that he might have taken extra on the lead might have been the difference between him being safe or out.
Really surprised to see Crockett stealing there with a seven-run lead in the eighth inning.
Johnson fouls another one back.
But Gus is probably thinking back to that 23-12 Oklahoma State-Arizona State game in the 84 College World Series. And we have, I think as recent as a year or two ago, Maine held an eight-run lead. Arizona came, that was last year.
Mm-hmm.
Arizona
That's
came
right.
back and beat them.
7-1 ball game that Maine led going into the seventh inning.
Like Joaquin Andujar said, one word sums up this game.
Yes.
You never know.
That's a long word. We go to the bottom of the eighth. Texas leading 13-6. Mike Oquist has pitched two shutout innings for Arkansas. Done a good job. Well, Texas protects the lead. They've got a seven-run lead. Pretty good odds that Cliff Gustafson will return to his hotel a winner.
Gotta like those percentages.
Well, Gustafson was worried.
How about that hat there?
That's the best one.
A lot of hogs. He's got a long way to go. Cheering him on.
Cliff Gustafson was worried going into this game. He felt because of the fact that Texas had beaten Arkansas 4 out of 5 that Arkansas might be a little hungry, a little more intense than his players, but it hasn't been the case. Texas has handled it well. Petkisic has pitched well and will go against Jim Phillips, who's pinch hitting to lead off the bottom of the eighth. Phillips, a junior from Texarkana, Texas. Hitting at 300. 28 hits and 70 at-bats this season. 9 home runs in those 28 hits. He's got some power. Petkisic has pitched 5 1/3 innings. Allowed 4 hits, 2 runs, only 1 earned. He's walked 1 and struck out 3. And what a contrast to the Arkansas pitchers who have walked 12 in the game. Petkisic settling down in relief of Garner has walked only one.
That's the secret. Get it over, keep it in the park, you got a chance.
Missed outside, and in this, his sixth inning of pitching, he's thrown 81 pitches, 54 strikes, and 27 balls. They got him looking. Threw him a slider and surprised Jim Phillips. Fourth strikeout for Petkisic.
Little soldier boy there, bat on your shoulder. Tough to hit the ball that way. And you see the movement on Petkisic's, kind of a sinking, looked like a slider to start out. Instead of breaking in, it had that late break, but it broke back across the inside corner. Good movement.
Hit hard by Scott Pose, backhanded by Lenny Bell. The toss to Petkisic, two men out. Well, Bell likes those hard ground balls. Give me those little squibbers.
Much easier to handle in those corkscrew spinners that were coming down. Well, I watched the footwork and the quick lateral movement right there by Bell. He's had a fine day in the field as well as a productive play day at the plate.
And just in case there's any trouble for Petkisic, Texas has John Morton loosening up.
Mentioned the Arkansas-Texas rivalry, and that Texas was a little uneasy about today's game. Another thing, Sam, is that Arkansas obviously not as bad a team as they've looked today. The reason they have looked so poorly today is the control problems their pitchers have had. And I really think that Guftas was concerned about the law of averages, that Arkansas is a good ball club, and it's tough to beat a club 4 out of 5.
Two men out. Kelly Zane, the second baseman, is the batter. He's 1 for 3 in the ball game. Breaking ball is down in the dirt. Two men out in the bottom half of the eighth inning. Texas leading 13-6. Hit hard. Nice play by Scott Coolbaugh at third. And the side's retired. 1-2-3 for Petkisic. He's now worked 6 1/3 and allowed only one earned run. It's 13-6 Texas as we go to the top half of the ninth inning. Right now, we're going to Boston Garden. John Saunders standing by with Casey Jones. John?
In a sweltering Boston Garden here in the tunnels of it, where it's been very wet. First of all, Casey Jones, I admire you. You kept your jacket on the whole game. But I want to tell you, I admire your team more because we knew it was well coached. We knew it was a great, talented team. But as you said, they showed a lot of chutzpah today.
Oh, no question about it. With Robert going out with the ankle and then coming back in again after being retaped, Larry is going 48 minutes. And then Kevin's up and down with a bad foot. I watched part of that Detroit game last Thursday from San Francisco, and it's hard for me to believe that these guys just hang in there like this. And that's what it takes is chutzpah, a lot of guts and a lot of determination. We went after 5 offensive rebounds and got them. We went after them. We could have just sat back, and then we put the three-pointer in, Danny put it in, and that really took it out of Detroit. And then what happens? The fans just really went over the edge. I mean, they just had noise. It was deafening, and that really helped us.
This series very nearly got away from you in game number 5. Larry Bird took control on that instance. Once again, he took control today. He is, without a question, the man who makes this team go.
Well, yeah, there's no doubt about it. We found a way in the fourth quarter to get him the ball where he had triple threat position, room to shoot from outside, drive, make the pass. Besides, he's doing the offensive and defensive rebounding, but the man got the ball and just would not let us lose the lead. He did not let us lose the game the other night.
Okay, as quickly, the Lakers are coming up next. This is a series that everybody says the winner of this series got the chance to get beat by the Lakers. Obviously, Casey Jones and the Celtics don't see it that way.
Well, we'll rest tomorrow, and I'm just very happy to be in the finals, and the same thing with the players.
Okay, Coach, thank you very much. Congratulations on a terrific win in a very hot Boston Garden here. So the Celtics will go on to play the Lakers. We'll have more on SportsCenter. Right now, let's go back to the College World Series.
Thanks, John. We're in the top half of the ninth inning.
Texas, leading 13-6. Alanis Westbrook to the plate for the sixth time of the ball game. Hits it high, deep to left center field, but playable. Rod Moore, the center fielder, is there to make the catch. Westbrook's two walks, hit by a pitch. And now 1-for-3 in 6 trips.
And just in case anybody joined us late, Sam, and saw that mask and said, I wonder what he's doing wearing something like that. We talked earlier in the ball game about the serious injury Alanis Westbrook suffered playing second base in an inter-squad game, and his teammate Mike Patrick went back in there, caught him with the knee, shattered the eye socket, cheekbone. He's lucky to be back playing.
That's 25 games returned to the lineup in the Central Regional, and is just starting to get back into shape and played a pretty good ball game. Here's Kobe Curlin, shortstop, senior shortstop for Texas. He played in the College World Series in 1985. Was a leadoff man then. Took a lot of pitches, walked a lot. Has the all-time Texas record for walks. He added to it today with one. Gives him 250 lifetime. Good fastball. Mike Oquist, freshman right-hander in his third inning. The fifth Arkansas pitcher in the ballgame. In a very down Arkansas dugout. They'll have to come back tomorrow night unless they can stage a miracle rally in the ninth inning. They're down by 7. Kurt Krippner, the All-America right-hander.
And the reason he's throwing right now, we'll explain that after this pitch.
Foul back by Curlin.
If Texas lost, of course, they would have had to play tomorrow night. Krippner would be the pitcher. Now, it appears that they're going to win with a 13-6 lead in the ninth inning. They will not play again until, did you say, Tuesday
night?
That's right. And so Krippner, having the extra days, wants to get the cannon loose.
Mm-hmm. And now Garner, who started today and really didn't have it, knocked out in the second inning. Walked 4 in the ballgame. Curlin has struck out for the second time. And Gardner now can come back next week. That's Kendall Traynor, a junior from Fredonia, Kansas, has moved into right field for Arkansas. Scott Pose, the right fielder who started the ballgame, has moved into left, and Dan Campbell has come out.
Gustafson has a little... several ways. He got several options with Garner having a poor performance today and Pet Kaiser looking very sharp. After Tuesday's game, he might elect to put Garner in the bullpen in that game and come back with Pet Kaiser in their third game.
Strong showing for Pet Kaiser. 6 in the third innings, 4 hits, walked only 1.
And not surprising. I mean, he came into this ball game 13-2. So he's been effective all year long.
This young man has got to be impressing Norm DeBryan, the freshman. Mike Oquist count as 2-0 on Brian Cesarek, who's 2-for-3 with 2 walks.
Kind of innings he's getting in right here, Oquist, as a freshman. But if Arkansas goes further into the series or gets back another year, this experience here will be very valuable to him. He could walk out on that mound in Omaha in another year or two and say, hey, I've been there. I know what it's like to walk in the ball game. And not a complete shock to him.
And, of course, giving Texas a look at him for next year when they battle again in the Southwest Conference. Who knows? Maybe even later in this tournament. Oquist can throw hard. He struck out 3. This is his third inning of pitching. 3-1 on Cesarek. Fastball foul back. And Oquist, the only Arkansas pitcher thus far who hasn't allowed a run. He started with left-hander John Sebahar. Left-hander Ray Harris came on in the second. Then it was right-hander Tim Peters in the fifth. Right-hander Bob Edwards in the sixth. And now Oquist in the seventh. And pitching here in the ninth inning.
That was yesterday, wasn't it, that Sebahar started?
Stanford and Georgia, the second game of our doubleheader today. Follow Sports Center. Changeup misses. Cesarek walks for the third time in this ballgame. That's 13 walks issued by Arkansas pitchers.
the third walk issued by Oakquist. Following this game, recap of all the sports news of the day. We go back to Sports Center, and then out here to Rosenblatt Stadium, where John Sanders and Joe Morgan will bring you the game between Stanford and Georgia. And of course, Tim Brando standing by alongside the dugouts.
How about this guy hitting right here, Sam? Texas' most productive hitter on the year, 15 home runs, 78 RBIs. Doesn't have a hit today and the only Texas player without an RBI.
Val tips it back. Count is 1-1.
You see that happen, you know, like if you follow a Yankee box score or whatever and they score 15 runs, you say, well, I know Mattingly had, you know, four RBIs. And then you check and say, wow, isn't that unusual? 0 for 5 and he didn't knock any in. And that's the case with Scott Coolball. Any other day, chances are he'd be the offensive leader. Today's shut out, doesn't have an RBI, and yet his team has 13 runs.
But again, a sign of how deep Texas is. They score 13 without their big guy producing anything. Cesarek has come through with a couple of hits. But the guys down the lower part in the batting order, Lenny Bell, the first baseman, batting seventh. Scott Bryant inserted as the DH.
Crockett,
the number eight hitter, and Brian Johnson has had a couple of hits. Crockett's had two hits, so Johnson. So they produced down the bottom of the order. Hit hard to right center field, and in for a base hit. Coolball's first hit. Cesarek on his way to third. And Texas with runners at first and third with two men out. So Scott Coolball gets his first hit of the ball game. The 13th hit of the game for Texas.
One thing we've talked about repeatedly today with the Texas hitters, and actually all of the hitters, their ability to go the other way with the pitch. Watch Scott Coolball right here. Takes that ball to right center field. One of the sins of young hitters and hitters in general is trying to pull the outside pitch. That's universal, little league to big leagues. These guys have all done a good job, really, of taking the ball the other way when it's on the outside part of the plate.
And here's the DH. Bryant, he's walked twice and had three hits, 3 for 3, and has gone very well to right field. Curveball from Oakquist. With that hit by Coolball, that leaves Todd Haney as the only Texas player in the ballgame without a base hit. Haney is on the on-deck circle. Cesarek, the runner at third. Coolball at first with two men out. Fastball foul tip back. Texas leading 13-6. We're in the top half of the ninth inning, and Todd Haney saying, one more try. I don't want to be the only guy without a hit. They'll be on me for the next 3 days. Freshman Scott Bryant swings the bat real well. Came into the game hitting 250. Looks more like a 350 hitter.
There's a young Butch Weiniger right there, that shot. Mike Oakquist.
Breaking ball on the ground, Oakquist stabbed it. And Oakquist pitches three shutout innings for Arkansas. Does a good job. We go to the bottom half of the ninth inning of game three with Texas leading 13-6. Bottom half of the ninth inning. Texas trying to close it out. Looking for their fifth win in six meetings with Arkansas. Coming up next after this ball game's over, we go to Sports Center. We'll update you on all the doings in sports today. Then back out here to Rosenblatt Stadium for game four, the final game of the first round of the NCAA College World Series, Stanford against Georgia. John Sanders, Joe Morgan, and Tim Brando will be standing by to bring you all the action. Her ball is foul back. This is Jim Kramer, the first baseman. He's done some outstanding hitting. He's been the hero for Arkansas, if you can have a hero in a losing effort like this. He's had two hits, five RBIs. Had a double off the top of the right field wall. Missed a grand slam by about 6 inches. And what a job. Again, one of these ball games with a big score, 13-6, where pitching has been overlooked. But don't overlook the effort of Mark Petkisic. Came on in relief in the second inning, has allowed two runs, only one earned. Given up just four hits and six in the third innings. And he's still got good stuff out there, throwing hard. 13-game winner. Junior from Beaumont, Texas. On the ground foul. Tim Brando, you're downstairs. What's going on in the Texas dugout?
Sam and Jim, if you're looking for a silver lining for Kevin Garner, though he did give up four runs in this game and went out in the second inning, they only pitched a few pitches, and that means that he'll be able to come back. And I talked with Cliff Gustafson. He'll start him on the Wednesday game. Of course, you'll have Krippner on Tuesday night in the winner's bracket contest.
Got him on a breaking ball. Petkazic picks up the strikeout.
Petkazic has shown us a live fastball, good slider, and watch that off-speed pitch right there, changeup. Good changeup that goes down right at the end, late break. Caught a lot of the Arkansas hitters out in front.
That's the fifth strikeout for Petkazic. Now, if Texas plays on Tuesday night in the winner's bracket, if they win, they wouldn't have to come back until Thursday night. So it would be even more rest. He could go have the option of Garner or Petkazic. Again, but the way Cliff Gustafson has been going, I would imagine Garner would be the choice, but there's Petkazic ready again. He would be well rested.
Start moving into the second round, Sam, of the double elimination tournament. You begin to see the teams that have the pitching depth. We know LSU has pitching depth, and now you see with the Texas staff, they're going to win this ball game, and they still have plenty of power out on the mound to come back with.
Andy Skiles bounces it to Todd Haney. Two men out. Skiles, the cleanup man for Arkansas, has been kept quiet. 0-for-4 in the ball game. Two men out. Todd Haney. Well, he didn't get a hit in the ball game.
He'll go 0 for every game in this series if his team can score 13 runs and win. I'll assure you of that. These guys want that championship ring. They don't care too much about batting averages and earned run averages.
Here's the DH, Troy Eklund, for Arkansas. Once again, Ryan Johnson, we're going to have to chip in, get him a new mask. He's thrown a couple away, and he's still having trouble with the one he's got on now. Mark Petkazic. Fastball hit in the air, short right center, is going to drop for a base hit. Second hit for Troy Eklund in the ball game.
Well, these control problems that Arkansas pitchers have had today, talk about Johnson's mask. Maybe they could start using the masks that the hockey goalies wear, you know, that have all the painted symbols and everything on. You could come up with some kind of a target to help your concentration get the ball to the strike zone. It'd be worth a try.
Five hits off Mark Petkazic. He's pitched seven innings. Here's the shortstop, Mike Sisko.
And they have the catcher's glove now with a fluorescent.
Right.
To help you zone in a little bit better.
That's a good one. Fastball, that's a base hit into right field. Eklund around second. It gets away from Cesarek, but the runner's hold. Eklund had an idea. Obviously, in a close game, he would have been going. But here, down by seven runs, no sense going. So two soft hits the opposite way for Arkansas. Puts runners at first and second with two men out. And Don Thomas, the third baseman, steps in. He's 0 for 3. Nine hits in the game for Arkansas. Arkansas led briefly, scored two runs in the bottom of the fourth to take a 6-5 lead. Up the middle, past the pitcher, Petkazic. Knocked down by Haney, the play at second, not in time. What an effort by Todd Haney. It's an infield single for Don Thomas. So a couple of Texas leaders, leaguers and a ground ball single, and the bases are loaded.
Should call these Arkansas leaguers, I guess. I think Petkazic thinks he should have had that ball, and he should have. The ball was not hit as hard as he thought. Great sliding stop by Haney. Example of what Gustafson said. Beginning of this season, he said, I don't think I can live with Todd Haney at second base, but he has shown more improvement than any player he's ever had defensively.
Here's Rod Moore, 2-for-3 in the game with two singles. That pitch is down low. So with two men out, Arkansas getting three singles to load the bases. Now, if there was nobody out, I guess there might be some concern in the Texas dugout. With two men out, Texas pretty safe here. And Kaiser goes for the fastball. And in the on-deck circle for Arkansas is a man who's hit so very well for them all season long, but has a broken left hand. That's number 20 you saw in the background, Randy Bob. Interesting to see if he comes up, if he gets a chance to hit. There's Randy Bob. In the Southwest Conference tournament, he was hit by a pitch and broke the small bone in his left hand. Kept him out since then. Fastball on the ground to Haney at second. This should do it. Over to Bell, and the ball game is over. The Longhorns of Texas getting some solid pitching from Mark Petkisic, who came on in the second inning in relief of Kevin Garner, have defeated the Razorbacks of Arkansas by the score of 13-6. Texas goes to the winner's bracket, and Arkansas has to come back tomorrow night in the loser's bracket.
Disappointing day for them, Sam. They're a better ball club than this, but when your pitchers don't throw strikes, makes your whole team look bad. Very encouraging for Gustafson, as Tim Brando pointed out. Kevin Garner with a bad day. Petkisic comes in, has a great effort. Now Garner is available next week along with their ace, Kurt Krippner. So the Longhorns are in great shape. Arkansas, of course, has to win tomorrow. They're going home.
Real good production for the Texas Longhorns from the bottom of the lineup. They break the game open with four in the fifth and four in the sixth and win it 13-6. We'll be right back.
Mercury introduces a new friend, Tracer. With 68 standard features, it's all there when you need it.
But here's one thing I know. Ooh, oh my love.
I made it safe now.
Mercury, the shape you want to be in.
Like many before, you came here asking for just one thing.
Sadowski! Szybowski!
A chance.
Pronounce Szybowski.
You're gonna make it here, cause you make America work, and this time's for you.
Here's to you, Beechwood Age, for that clean, crisp taste.
Hey, Sid!
That says Budweiser.
This Bud's for you.
When his team, the El Segundo Eagles, lost the 1970 state final, George Brett didn't lose his desire. He didn't give up, because George Brett has always had a will to win. And he's always had a Wilson.
Texas beats Arkansas for the fifth time in six meetings this season. They win it 13-6. Coming up next, right here on ESPN, we'll take you to SportsCenter. A full recap of the day's doings in the world of sports and a lot of action. NBA playoffs, boxing, look at baseball and everything else going on. Then right back out here to Rosenblatt Stadium where John Sanders and Joe Moore.